Hi, I'm John, the banking systems engineer at Termel, and this is an article out of the Toronto Star called A Cure for Depression, Try Funny Money. Shouldn't make fun of a good idea. A challenge in any economic downturn is getting people to part with cash. One solution from the 1930s, scrip, a currency that's taxed if it isn't spent. That's called demurrage, and it's totally unnecessary. Linda Hurst, feature writer. Not since the Great Depression have the world's major economic powers piled into such a collective train wreck as the current recession. As Bank of Canada Governor Mark Carney put it this week, issues of financial stability that were once the obsession of a pessimistic few are now the daily concern of many. One of the biggest concerns is deflation. Carney said the chance is remote that Canada will be hit by a sustained bout of deflation, but the bank's own monetary policy report forecasts total inflation will drop below zero in the coming months. That, for some financial experts, is too close for comfort. Gotta have some inflation. They're financial experts. Deflation happens when falling prices induce people to postpone buying until prices fall even further. Therefore, cash starts to drop out of circulation. Falling consumption coupled with money saving, or hoarding as economists call it, hastens the kind of deflationary spiral that led to the 1930s depression. Yeah, people are hoarding their money, not that they're broke. Globally, governments are employing all manner of means to ward that off, stimulate their economies, and get money moving. All ideas welcome. Well, the Unilet's interest-free idea isn't welcomed by the banks, who get cut out of the equation. It becomes a social servant by the government, a utility, banking, instead of a profit enterprise for a few rich families. Ever thus, in the interregnum between World Wars I and II, a small town in Germany tried an unusual anti-deflation approach, printing an alternative currency called stamp scrip. Granted, the Weimar Republic isn't exactly a role model of how Canada or any other nation might prod spending and investment, but the practice was also adopted in the US. And a more famous example is the town of Wargel in Austria, and you wonder why she's not talking about Wargel, but that was stopped by the government. Scrip is a substitute for cash, often a form of credit. Think of Canadian Tire money, but usable elsewhere. How many times have I used that example? But it doesn't get through. After World War I, Germany experienced hyperinflation when the government tried to get rid of debt by printing more currency. Then the Depression hit, and with money in short supply, the problem reversed into runaway, crippling deflation. So from wheelbarrows to not enough. What'd they do, burn it for fuel? In 1929, the small Bavarian village of Schwanenkirchen, whose sole industry was a now closed down coal mine, barely existing. Almost everyone was in debt. Then the mine owner heard about Wara, stamp scrip, an idea proposed years earlier by economist theorist Silvio Gesell. He believed that a periodic tax placed on money in the form of dated stamps would loosen people's grasp on their cash during economic downturns. The mine owner got a loan in official currency and bought the scrip from the Wara Exchange Association, a voluntary group of merchants, manufacturers, and business firms. So he bought money to get some chips. All right. In small, convenient denominations, that's right, it was used as wages and for trade. Okay. Wara was designed with 52 spaces on the reverse side, one for each week of the year. It held the value of its stated denomination only for 1 week. Then a stamp costing 1% of the face value had to be affixed on the back. Stamps were bought at the association's bank. Well, that was a way of funding the guys who ran the system. Okay. But it's totally unnecessary. The guys could simply run a regular chip bank and pay themselves and then add that to normal expenses. So having a demurrage charge changes the value of the money, and that's what's stupid about it. You'll see. The procedure kept the scrip from being stashed away, as people would spend it prior to the stamp's due date. Wara ultimately was accepted in thousands of stores throughout Germany. The experiment was so successful, it was dubbed the Miracle of Schwanenkirchen in a New Republic article. Same thing with Wargel in Austria, a miracle. People went from total unemployment to everybody working really hard and producing lots of stuff. So remember Wargle. No one who received Wara wished to hold it. It kept on circulating, a large part returning to the coal mine, where it provided work, profits, and better conditions for the entire community. Workers and merchants were free from debts, and a new spirit of freedom and life pervaded the town. Same thing in Wargle, Austria. All right. Eminent Yale economist Irving Fisher would write approvingly that news of the town's prosperity in the midst of the Depression spread widely, but no explanation was given as to the real cause of the miracle, that the non-hoardable money was being tried out and that was working marvelously. Hey, money, when there's none, would work marvelously, let alone the non-hoardable one, because you add a tax to it. The new Nazi government, however, fearing Wara would somehow reignite inflation, prohibited it in 1933. The village, it was soon back on the dole. Ah, that's why they don't talk about Wargle, because in Austria, the Austrian government did the same thing. They stopped it, shut it down. The only difference was Hitler took over the operation and he said, I'm going to run a Reichsmark system based on people's time and put everybody to work. And in Australia, they didn't. So Hitler shut down the one with the timestamps and gave them a good one without the timestamps. Meanwhile, Fisher was arguing that stamp script could break the back of the Depression in the U.S. Any script could. But he failed in his 1932 bid for a nationwide script issue of $1 billion that would be declared legal tender. Yay! And yet hundreds, too bad, eh? In the middle of the Depression, he says, let's use some community currency for the nation, and he was voted down. The people caring for their constituents in part. Yet hundreds of regional scripts went into circulation anyway. Thousands, I heard. In denominations of 25 cents to $5. At best, their success was limited and local. Well, what do you want? Of course it was. FDR wouldn't help do a national one. When FDR brought in the New Deal, he abolished the use of all emergency currencies and then kept them poor for the next 7 years. Just like Adolf and just like in Austria. They all seem to have done that, except Adolf took over the printing presses while Roosevelt in Austria didn't. There's logic in these monetary experiments if the concern is to combat deflation, says University of Toronto economic historian John Monroe, but scrip isn't a long-term solution. He's an expert in banking systems engineering, right? And it's not needed now. People got no money soon. We'll see. We're not in the position Germany was in the 1920s or Zimbabwe is today. Yeah, it's not bad enough yet, so we may as well not get ready. A form of scrip is still used in Bavaria. Since 2003, a substitute currency, the Chiemgauer, has been spent alongside the euro in more than 600 shops and businesses, and some workers are paid in it. Well, that's community currency happening out there, and no talk about the stamp on the back of it. So they got rid of the stupid part, and they're doing it right. The Chiemgauer, however, is less about preventing deflation than encouraging local spending. At least it was until now. Hey, link it to time and you can spend it in Canada too. So, Linda Hurst, feature writer for the Toronto Star, reachable at lhurst@thestar.ca, didn't bother mentioning about the Toronto dollar system right in her own hometown, giving it a plug, and it would work too. So, yes, community currencies are valuable. They call them funny money in the old days to make people try and think that, oh, if they add this funny money into circulation, there's going to be shift A inflation. Of course, only we who follow these videos know about shift B inflation and how adding money into circulation will actually bring down inflation like it did in Argentina in the 80s when all those provinces dumped all those provincial bonds into circulation and the bankers would be crying it's going to go up from 1,000% and yet it went down to 36%. Because it cut back on foreclosures. Check shift B inflation. So no more making funny of funny money. The cure for depression, yes, it's a script money based on time that everybody can accept and interchange. I'm John, the banking systems engineer, showing you a way out of the depression. So yes, community currencies work, but you don't need a demurrage negative feedback charge to spur people to use it. When they have enough, they don't need to be spurred. They'll use it exactly as they need it. So to sit there and have to look through your money and say, okay, this one is worth only 51%, and this one's worth 57%, and this one's worth 92%, and have to call, what a stupid way to run money, making your chip lose value every week, even if you want to collect somehow to pay for the expenses. There are smarter ways, a rake-off or a service fee. Ask any casino the smart way to pay for the running of the chips, but certainly not changing the value of the chips every week. That's stupid. But it does spur people to use the chips if they're losing their value by next week. Yes, I agree there. So, how did the whole world continue in depression after FDR outlawed community currencies in the States and the rest of the world, and yet Hitler managed to put everybody back to work, build a huge war machine, build autobahns, give people Volkswagens, good health care, good education? How'd he do that in the middle of a depression when everybody else was unemployed? Well, here's the example. In America, FDR banned the community currencies and let the people be the victims of the banksters who wouldn't lend them any money. While in Germany, Hitler had an engineer called Gottfried Feder who insisted on an interest-free banking system, which makes it time-based automatically. And that explains how Hitler could finance an interest-free national reconstruction system while FDR couldn't. And the rest of the world stayed in depression too. So it's up to us to simply do the one great thing that Nazi Germany ever did, and that was to set up an interest-free banking system, except we ain't gonna build guns, we're gonna build tractors.